Today we will be learning about the distribution system. So after the treatment and filtration treatment of the water, finally we have to distribute the water to the public. So this is the last system or the last step in the distribution process basically. So after the disinfection, we are going to distribute the water to the public, right? After this, again, after distribution, it has to go through plumbing and all. So that comes in the plumbing part. Let us learn more about the distribution process. Yeah. So the first requirement is that it should supply water to all the places and with sufficient pressure. Right? So this is a very fair and very common requirement that it should be such that your water reaches all the places. No place is devoid of getting that water supply, and obviously the sufficient pressure head also should be maintained so that the water which is coming to your house, it can be easily stored in your own tanks which are there, which is generally on the terrace or somewhere, so wherever that water tank is there, this water supply should easily go in that. That's why the pressure head is required. Second is the supply that is coming from the distribution system, that it should be enough for firefighting. Okay, and this is a very straight and forward requirement. Should be economical, obviously, because the distribution system is one of the most highest financially, economically required system in the entire water supply process. So it takes almost 70% of the total cost. It should be simple and easy to maintain and operate. Should be safe from pollution. Keeping away from sewer lines is one of the major requirements, because if the sewer line is very close by, and if God forbid some cracks develop or some leakage is there between the sewer lines and our main distribution line, then it may cause pollution in the water, right? Should be safe from bursting of pipelines. So you should use such pipes which are safe for the pressure by which the water is going to be flown through those pipes, and they should not burst. It should be watertight to minimize losses due to leakage. So this is another requirement, that the distribution system should not leak, or otherwise there is wastage of treated water. Now all of these brings us to the layouts of distribution system. The distribution pipes are generally laid below the road pavements, and as such their layout will generally follow the layouts of the road. So you might have seen that whenever there is some water works going on, the first thing that they do is they excavate the part of the road, generally because these distribution networks, they are placed underneath the roads, and therefore wherever the road will go and however the road will go, likewise the distribution of the pipes will also go that way. So what exactly this distribution network means, that how your pipes are laid, in what manner, how are they going. So that is just your distribution network, that's it. And generally it is said that they follow the roads. There are in general four different types of pipe networks, any one of which either singly or in combination can be used at a particular place depending upon the local conditions and orientation of the roads. So let us learn about those four different types of pipe networks. First is dead end system, grid iron system, ring system and radial system. Let us learn one by one. First is dead end system. So this is how the dead end system looks. There is one main pipe. This pipe, water is going to come, the treated water is going to be flowing through this main pipe. Then here you see the cutoff valves or the gate valves. They are also called as sluice valves, S-L-U-I-C-E, sluice valves. What they do is they allow the water to go in this pipe. So this will be called as a main pipe, the one from which the water is coming, and these are called as sub main pipes because they are deriving their water from the main pipe. So they are called as sub main pipes. These valves will regulate that flow. They will either allow the water to come, or they can also stop the water to come in these pipes. And then further, when the sub main pipes are divided or into other pipes, they are called as branch pipes. So these are your branch. So it is also called as a tree system. This because you know, there is a main, then sub main, then further it is getting divided into, just like a tree branch, there's a main trunk, then it gets divided into small branches, then again small twigs and all. Each sub main then divides into several branch pipes called laterals. From the laterals, service connections are given to the consumers. This type of layout may have to be adopted for older towns which have developed in a haphazard manner without properly planned roads. So you see that, as I already told you, the distribution network is generally laid below the roads. You see the roads are in any manner, they are not in a proper organized way, right? So for such old cities where the roads were not built in an organized manner, this dead-end distribution system can be used. The water supply mains have then to be taken along the main road and branches taken off wherever needed, thus resulting in the formation of a number of dead ends. What are dead ends is that, see this, assume that the water is coming like this from the main, then it is entering here in this pipe, then it is entering here in the branch or the laterals, then it is going here and it is stopping, right? So there is no way for the water to go away from here. Again, here also it is going to stop. So there is a dead end to the water. The system is therefore suitable for localities which expand irregularly and where the water pipes have to be laid at random. What are the advantages of this? The theoretical calculations are easier, that is, the calculation of discharge and pressure points at various locations is easier for this network. Lesser number of cutoff valves, that is Lewis valves, as I told you, these cutoff valves, they are required in lesser number, like in this entire system where it is dividing into a lot of sub mains and branches, you can see that only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, almost 5 to 6 cutoff valves are only required. Shorter pipe lengths are needed and the laying of pipes is easier. It is cheap and simple and can be extended easily. So in this, if you want to expand further, just get one more branch here, then one more, just, you know, keep on expanding like this in a very haphazard manner. So it is simple in this system. Disadvantages are major. First is, since water travels only through one route, any damage or repair in any pipeline will completely stop the water supply in the area. Consider that one of the pipelines here is damaged. Let's say this pipeline is damaged. This pipeline. So my system should be such that if I want to repair this pipeline, the people who are getting water by this pipeline should not be affected. But in this system, what happens? First of all, if you want to repair the pipeline, you will have to stop the water in that particular area. So to stop the water, we have this cutoff valve here. You cut off the valve, what happens? The water supply is stopped to the entire area, right? So that is what happens generally. In this, that is a big disadvantage. Dead end prevents free circulation of water and stagnates the water. Now these dead ends, what they do, when the water comes here like this, it does not circulate from here. It stops, kind of stops here, right? And since there is no circulation of water in the entire system, the water stagnates and it has to be supervised more or inspected more as compared to the other systems. Since in this system the discharge is reaching a point from only one direction, the supplies during firefighting cannot be increased by diverting any supply from any other side. For example, let us say that we need some water for a fire supply, okay, and only this main pipeline is going to provide the water here, right? So we are made to rely only on one pipe, there is no other pipe which is joining it, which can, you know, increase the water supply which is required during fire breakouts and for the fire diffusing. So that is one of the disadvantages. Hence, it gives limited supplies and may prove to be a handicap. The second system is grid iron system. You can already see from the image that there are a lot of cutoff valves in this as compared to the dead end system. Plus, the water is how it is moving. This is the main pipe. It is moving like this. It is moving up, down. So there is a circulation of water here. It can go like this, you know. So it can move freely around everywhere. In this system, which is also known as interlaced system or reticulation system, the mains, submains and branches are all interconnected with each other as shown in figure. In fact, in a well-planned city or a town, the roads are generally developed in a grid iron pattern and the pipelines in such places can follow them easily. So generally in a well-planned city, the roads are also developed in this manner only, that there is a let us say a main road. From main road you get another sub road, and from that it leads to some small alleys and, you know, other things like that. Hence, this system is more suitable for well-planned towns and cities, and it has been used in Chandigarh, which is a very well-planned city. Advantages of this system is that since water reaches at different places through more than one route, the discharge to be carried by each pipe, the friction loss and the size of the pipe therefore gets reduced. You can see that here the to reach maybe here this point, it has more than one way. It can come like this, it can also come like this. So if the demand here was, let's say, 10 cubic meter, we can provide 5 cubic meters from this side, 5 cubic meters from this side, thereby reducing the discharge in each of the sub pipes. And also, if the discharge is reduced, obviously the size of the pipe can be reduced, and consequently the friction losses can also be reduced in that. In case of repairs, very small area will be devoid of complete supply. So let us say that you want to repair this pipe itself. So what you do, you block this valve and this valve, that's it. The entire supply in this area is blocked, but the supply in the other areas continue to be there. Because of the different interconnections, the dead ends are completely eliminated and therefore water remains in continuous circulation, as I already told you. During fire, more water can be diverted towards the affected points from various directions by closing and manipulating various cutoff valves. So let us say that I want some water here, okay, in this case. What I can do, first of all the mains are coming, I am getting water from mains as it is. It is going to come here, from here it is going here and like this. But apart from that, instead the water going here in this pipe and this pipe, I can block the water from going in those pipes by just disconnecting these valves. I can disconnect these valves such that the water will not get distributed here, but the entire of the water, again this valve I can disconnect, the entire of the water can come here and go here. So you get more water supply wherever required. So this is one of the flexibility of this methods. Disadvantages, this system requires more length of pipes, as you can already see that as compared to the dead end system, there are a lot of pipes and more cutoff valves. Obviously, its construction is costlier. The design is difficult and costlier. The calculation for determining accurately the size of the pipes and the pressure at various key points is a real tedious job and may even require the services of design experts and even computers, because how the discharge is going to be distributed in each pipe, that is difficult to estimate, especially when you have the flexibility of turning off some valves. So if you, let's say you close this valve, the discharge in other pipes will be automatically changed, and thereby it can also affect the design carrying capacity of that pipe also. Third is called as ring system. A ring system, in this what happens that the mains, instead of going centrally, the mains are at the periphery of it. Here like this, this dark line that you see, these are nothing but your mains, and from here it can go inside. This is similar to your grid iron system. The only thing is that the mains are at the periphery of your grid or the blocks that you can see. This is a formation of grid itself, right? So this system is also sometimes called a circular system. In this system, a closed ring, either circular or rectangular, of the main pipes is formed around the area to be served as shown. The distribution area is divided into rectangular or circular blocks, and the main water pipes are laid on the periphery of these blocks. The sub mains may be placed as shown. So sub mains, obviously they derive from the mains. And the cutoff valves are also placed at the periphery itself, as you can see here. Then the ring system is very suitable for towns and cities having well planned roads. Sometimes this system is used as a loop feeder placed centrally around high demand area. So if there's an area which requires more water supply, you can place the mains at the periphery of that area, and from all the sides it can receive water. So that is a good part. In such cases, this enhances the capacity of the gridiron system and will improve the pressure at various points. The advantages and disadvantages of this are same as that of gridiron system. The last one is radial system. As you can see, there is a main pipe, then there is sub main. It reaches here, and from this point it goes in all the directions. So this is sub main, and these can be called as branches. So this is your main pipe, this is sub main pipe, and these can be called as branches. Right? If a city or town is having a system of radial roads emerging from different centers, the pipelines can be best laid in a radial method by placing the distribution reservoirs at these centers. So this is what if the city is having this kind of radial system of roads connected, then this method is best. One more very important advantage of this method would be that since the water is going to get distributed from this point everywhere, the pressure in all these branch pipes would be same. Since only from one point it is going everywhere, the pressure in all the branch pipes would be same, and it will ensure that all the places receive equal amount of pressure. In this system, water is therefore taken from the water mains and pumped into distribution reservoirs placed at different centers. Distribution reservoirs are nothing but storage tanks where the water is stored, and from distribution reservoir it is like how we have small tanks at our home. Those small tanks serve as whenever we require water, the water comes from those tanks in our houses, right? If you are staying in a building, your building will have a big tank. From that big tank, the water comes every day to our homes. In our homes, we have small tanks of those Sintex and all. We fill the water, we place the water, water is filled in those tanks for our use. Similarly, like the building has that big tank, for the entire city, these distribution reservoirs are like those big tanks. So the water is first going to fill these distribution reservoirs, and from these reservoirs, it is going to get pumped to different places. Not pumped exactly, but it is going to be distributed to different places. The water is then supplied through radially laid distribution pipes. This method ensures high pressure and efficient water distribution. So as I told you that the pressure is distributed equally, and all the places can be ensured to receive a good pressure. The calculation for designs of sizes are also simple, and this is it. In the next lecture, we will be learning about the methods of distribution layouts. Till then, see you in the next lecture. Thank you.